Well, I think if we were to talk about Formula One, I think you did a great job. Yeah. I think we finished the setting the scene really well. A couple of points that were mentioned out that I'd just like to highlight for everybody was, one, whatever we have done isn't working. Right? Whatever we have spent is of no use. Right? What we're talking about is to have a situation where we look at, a one-way flow of water. You take the water from the water bodies and then never return it back, thereby using that water subsequently for tertiary treatment. Right? You know, it's almost like developing a strategy where we are actually creating an insurance for water availability for a very long time. You know, so a couple of great points, and with that, I'll request Mr. Indra Mitra to start off in his sessions and comments about what has been set up.
Thank you. Zero liquid discharge is becoming a norm, especially in India. There are many good points about having zero liquid discharge, but there are also some negative impacts also. Zero liquid discharge, from the implementation point of view, as our history shows, many of the industries, you know, they were supposed to treat the water, wastewater, and then discharge it. They were not doing their things. So from the implementation point of view, zero liquid discharge is definitely a good thing because, you know, the moment any industry discharge any water, whether it is meeting the norms or not, it doesn't matter. You immediately can catch it. That is the easiest part of the zero liquid discharge. What is the problem with the zero liquid discharge? I mean, there are two things. One is, like I said, is the implementation part. Another is the technological part. From the technological point of view, zero liquid discharge, we have to go a little step forward to find out how this is achieved in the industries particularly. If it is simple tertiary treatment, and say for gardening, or things like that, you know, for toilets, washing, and everything, it is definitely a very good thing to do. And this is a very, very environmentally safe and environmentally friendly method. The second thing is obviously you will be, the more you reuse, you will be taking in less water from if you do a mass balance. And so obviously this protects our natural waters. The only thing that causes a little concern is when you try to reuse the water by using membrane technologies, particularly reverse osmosis. The problem with the reverse osmosis process, it produces, I mean, the good part is it produces very clean water, which you can use for your high-end uses like cooling towers and other things. But the problem is, number one, is the energy. When you put in a membrane system, your energy costs are high. So this power is generated somewhere in some power plants, which is emitting carbon dioxide. And I was just in the other session, and there was a very good point made that every power that we use, four times that power is actually being produced. So if you produce four units of power, only one unit is utilized because of, you know, transmission losses and efficiency and all those things. So the more the power requirement means, the more is your carbon emission. That is one thing. Next thing, biggest, one of the big problem is after the RO, you generate a reject stream. What do you do with that? The whole world is grappling with this problem. Now you have converted an innocuous wastewater, which is after tertiary treatment, is pretty good quality wastewater. Now you have a wastewater that you treat, and then you created this reject stream, and this reject streams can be as high as, you know, 50% of the flow, depending on the size. I mean, it varies between 20 to 50%. So you have generated a wastewater which is high in TDS. how you're going to get rid of it. Some are using incinerators, some are using evaporators. Again, those are energy intensive. So my only issue is, when you look at anything, look at it from the holistic point of view, from the environment point of view holistically, not just look at from the water. From water, yes, it is good. But are you creating problem in another area? That is something you need to address. One way to do it, like I said, is encourage recycle and reuse without membranes. That is absolutely a very good proposition. But when it comes to membranes, a better evaluation needs to be done. There's a recent article about 3-4 months ago by Pepsi Global Director, Technical Director. They have used these membranes in their plants, and they won the Stockholm Award this year for their good water, you know, program. He has commented that, you know, we will now use membranes because it is so costly, it's expensive, only in places where water is really, really an issue. Like, say, you go to a desert where water is definitely an issue. So that thing has to be also taken into account while making any decision. And the second thing may be, you know, we, from the administrative or from the government side, it is much easier to say go for zero discharge. But the onus is now shifted from the government to the industry. Now, how the industry is going to cope up with it? This reject is a big, big issue. So one way is like having a common effluent treatment plant and then doing something from there, because it is then your monitoring points. This is just my suggestion, is monitoring points becomes much less. Like if you have one region, one plant, you know, in the US, what we used to have, we have is the municipal treatment plant does take in a lot of industrial wastewater, but there are some industrial pre-treatment standards which the industry has to maintain. So, you know, so from the technological point of view, from the environment point of view, my vote will be go for always zero liquid discharge, provided if you don't have a membrane. If you have a membrane system, if you have to install a membrane system, then you know, you have to give it a second thought and then evaluate it on a case-by-case basis. One of the options may be to have you know, centrally effluent treatment plant or centrally treatment plant where you know, a lot of industries can discharge, like a common effluent treatment plant, and then so you have only one monitoring point. That is one thing. Another thing is also when we go for zero liquid discharge, one thing is CPCB recently came up with a regulation for nitrate for 10 milligrams per liter. But the TKN values are kept as same as 100 and ammonia limits are 50. So from the regulation point of view, it doesn't really, is not a consistent regulation. And because this TKN and ammonia numbers were there from before, and in 2009, December, I think, the nitrate number were imposed. And what happens is if you, many people use this treated wastewater for recycle and reuse into the groundwater. Now this water goes down, and then basically your water becomes high in nitrates. And nitrates, as you know, is well known for blueberries, blue baby syndrome, and this groundwater down the line is used, is, you know, is some people is drinking that water. So you need to be careful, you know, when you go there. So my only suggestion is when you go for this, you just have to do a very thorough analysis, go a step forward, maybe a two steps forward, finding out what technologies are we going to, what we do in such cases, instead of putting something across the board. And that's my take on that.
Thank you. So a couple of the things that were highlighted was in terms of, you know, technology. We be aware that you know, if you do use a type of technology, for example, membranes, you know, you have other things to worry about because of rejects and things like that. But in terms of the possibility of being able to do reuse, it can be done. the norms and standards have to be maintained in order for us to be able to achieve something that's reasonable. Next, I'll request Dr. Deendayal, you know, to address the audience again. Is this a possibility to have a one-way use of water? You know, take the water in and then either you use it for recycle, reuse, or recharge. You know.
I am Dr. M. Deendayalan, Deputy Advisor, CPHO, Ministry of Urban Development. The topic on zero liquid discharge, yes, it is a very good concept. But how far it is implementable, that is questionable. I was thinking, what is the time frame required to bring the zero liquid discharge concept with the existing constraint like lack of resources, capacity building, and the existing sanitation scenario in the country. Before going into the concept of zero liquid discharge, we should realize under what circumstances we are living, what is the sanitation situation in the country. I just want to highlight that in India, if you see, the total urban population is about 377 million, which accounts for 31.2% of the total population. There are 7,935 towns and cities in the country. If you just want to know what is the current sanitation situation, as per 2011 census of Government of India, about 38.2% urban households rely on septic tanks. Please imagine the situation. About 32.7% urban households are connected with sewerage systems, and 16.5% urban households rely on community toilets, some twin pit toilets, and insanitary toilets like single pit latrines and dry latrines and bahu type of latrines. This is the situation. And if you see, the population which is going for open defecation is about 12.6%. This is the current situation. Why the scenario is? Whether it is due to lack of fund constraint, or due to managerial issue, or due to capacity building with the urban local bodies, or constraint with the state government, or is there any failure in the policy or environmental law? These are the issues to be debated. It is very easy to say to bring zero liquid concept, but how to achieve that needs to be discussed. From my experience in the ministry, I would like to say that ministry has taken lot of initiatives. Like in 2005, Ministry of Urban Development has launched JNURM, under which about 112 projects with a total cost of 14,993 crores have been approved, under which about 6,500 MLD is being created. And subsequently, in 2008, Ministry of Urban Development has formulated National Urban Sanitation Policy, according to which each state government has to prepare state sanitation strategies and cities have to prepare city sanitation plan and implement the same with their own funds. And the ministry also brought out service level benchmark with a focus to shift from infrastructure creation to service delivery to achieve the international best practices. Fourthly, ministry has also brought out various manuals with respect to water supply and sanitation sector. Currently, the existing manual on sewerage and sewage treatment is being revised. We are going to prepare three manuals, one on engineering manual that is under revision, a new manual on O&M of sewerage system, and third manual on management of sewerage system. This is under revision. This will take some time for publication. And with the current situation, what